When Americans list the great rock and roll originators, Eddie Cochran's name hardly ever appears, while in England he's revered almost as much as Elvis. Rock historian Ed Ward profiles the career of a performer who pioneered multi-track recording and contemporary production techniques, had hits which became classics, and died at the age of 21.
Here she comes. Here comes that girl again. Wanted to meet her since I don't know when. But she don't notice me when I pass. She goes with older guys from out of my class. But that can't stop me from thinking to myself. She's your fine looking man. She's something else.
Eddie Cochran was probably the first American rock and roller to be far more celebrated outside his native country than in it. It's a shame because in many ways he was an innovator and a technological pioneer. He was born in Minnesota in 1938, but his family moved to the LA suburbs when he was 12. 3 years later, he'd formed a three-piece country band with a couple of his neighbors, and 2 years after that, he dropped out of high school to go professional. He teamed up with Hank Cochran, no relation, as the Cochran Brothers, Eddie dropping the E from the end of his name to make it look good. They didn't get far, although Hank Cochran would go on to write a slew of classic country songs, but they did attract the attention of a man named Jerry Capehart, who had decided that Eddie, at least, was star material. At a time when everybody was looking for the next Elvis, Capehart managed to get Eddie signed to Liberty Records, where his first single was a hit.
I'm just a sitting in the back, and just a watching a movie. Or maybe it's a symphony. I wouldn't know. I don't care about the symphony. Those are symbols and the tune. I'm just a sitting in the back, on the very last row. And I hold your hand.
Sitting in the Balcony, oddly enough, sold better with black record buyers than white, but it meant that his career had begun. But the follow-ups failed, one after another, whether they were copycat takeoffs on the hit or they were top-quality rockers like this one.
Ooh, well, I've got a gal with a record machine. When it comes to rocking, she's a queen. We'll have to dance on a Saturday night. I'll hold her long where I can hold her tight. But she lives on the 20th floor of town. The elevators are broken down, so I walk 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 more. Up on the 12th, I'm suddenly dragged. 15th, 4, I'm ready to sound. Get to the top, I'm too tired to run. Well, she called me up on the telephone. Say, come on over.
20 Flight Rock even made it into the film The Girl Can't Help It, where Eddie performs the song on television while Tom Ewell's middle-aged black maid swoons over him, but it didn't sell. It took a lot of touring and a lot of effort, but finally, in the summer of 1959, Eddie had another hit.
I'm a gonna raise a fuss, I'm a gonna raise a holler. About a working all summer just to try to earn a dollar. Every time I call my baby, try to get a date, my boss says,
no dice, son, you gotta work late.
Sometimes I wonder what I'm a gonna do, but there ain't no cure for the summertime blues.
Summertime Blues has assumed classic status by now, but if you listen to it on a good stereo, you'll notice it has an odd sound. That's because one of the side benefits of being based in Hollywood was that you got to play around in recording studios, and Eddie had learned how to overdub himself. All of the instruments and voices on Summertime Blues are Eddie Cochran. It was a substantial hit, and maybe that explains why the follow-up flopped. Or rather, it flopped in the U.S. It went top 10 in England, and his manager Jerry Capehart decided that that was probably where Eddie should go next. he started working on plans for a tour. Meanwhile, 19-year-old Eddie had fallen in love. Sharon Sheely is a teenage songwriter who'd provided the Everly Brothers and Ricky Nelson with hits, and she'd met Cochran when they'd both shown up to see Don Everly flat on his back in a hotel with the flu. She auditioned some of her songs for Eddie and Capehart, and Eddie was fairly arrogant to her. Sheely fled in tears, and Capehart said, "You just chased away $1 million. By New Year's Eve, he definitely changed his mind. She showed up at a party he was at, and he was so captivated that he asked her to marry him on the spot. But he was also acting weird. Buddy Holly's death in a 1959 plane crash hit him hard, and he recorded a pathetic tribute song to him.
Look up in the sky, up towards the north. There are three new stars, brightly shining forth. They're shining oh so bright from heaven above. Gee, we're gonna miss you. Everybody sends their love."
Towards the end of the song, he actually cries. He began to seem indifferent to his career, although he continued writing songs with Sheely and Capehart and recording them. Finally, the British tour came together. He'd be on the bill with Gene Vincent, long since washed up in the States, but a huge star in Britain thanks to Jack Good, who swathed him in black leather and made him seem menacing. Eddie went into the studio to cut a few more songs, and then he left for the tour. It was a huge success, and he flew Sheely over to be with him. He told her he wanted to spend more time in the studio, that they'd finally get married, and that this was his last tour. He was right on one count. On April 18, 1960, he, Vincent, and Sheely were in a limo on their way to Heathrow Airport to fly home when a tire blew at high speed and the car plowed into a lamppost. All three went to the hospital, and Eddie died of head injuries 2 days later. Sharon Sheely returned home alone.